Have you ever looked at the graphics tab in the settings of a game and went, "What the hell is anisotropic filtering?" Well, hopefully this video should help. Anyway, without further ado, here's every graphics setting explained in a short but undetermined amount of time. Trademark.
Resolution.
Your screen is made up of a bunch of tiny squares called pixels. Resolution changes the number of pixels your game would be rendered at.
Render scale slash frame scaling slash frame.
It's like resolution, except it only affects the actual 3D and not the UI.
Aspect ratio.
This is the ratio, haha, funny twiddle, of the screen's width and height. The most common aspect ratio is 16:9. If you're watching this on a computer, chances are your screen is 16:9.
Refresh rate.
Monitors refresh a certain number of times every second. If you're playing in full screen, this will tell the game how often your screen should be refreshing every second.
Anti-aliasing.
When games are rendered without anti-aliasing, every pixel can only define one thing. Let's take a look at a screenshot. You see that? A pixel can only either be the gun or the ground. There's no in-between. This is where anti-aliasing comes along. There are multiple types of anti-aliasing which attempt to fix this. Let's go over the easiest ones.
Fast approximate anti-aliasing.
This one is dumb. It thinks about contrast and edges for a bit, and then it just blurs the screen. That doesn't mean it doesn't have its uses though. If you're running the game at a high resolution, it does make edges smoother without eating up frames per second like other anti-aliasing methods. Speaking of,
multi-sample anti-aliasing.
MSAA is a little bit smarter than FXAA. It checks a number of spots on each pixel and blends them together. Say you want to draw a line. Without anti-aliasing, each pixel can either be black or white. But with 2x MSAA, each pixel can be white, black, but it can also be grey. The 2x refers to how many spots MSAA checks. In most games, this can go up to 8x, meaning that it checks 8 spots per pixel. So each pixel can be 8 different colors, even though we're only drawing a completely black line. I'm not gonna go deeper into anti-aliasing in this video, but if you wanna know more, check that link in the description.
Texture quality.
Every surface, whether it be a wall, one face of a crate, or the underside of a table, is an image. This image is called a texture, and games usually have thousands of them. The only thing texture quality changes is the resolution of these images.
Anisotropic filtering.
Having this setting turned down means that faraway textures will be blurry. Just keep it at 16x unless you care about getting one more frame per second. That's right, it makes textures look terrible and it doesn't even help with performance.
Shader quality.
This usually makes lighting and hair more realistic. This setting differs a lot between different games, but those are the most popular uses of shaders. Except if you're playing Minecraft.
Shadow quality.
It's like texture quality, but for shadows.
Reflection quality.
I wonder what this one is.
Particle quality.
It changes the same thing as the last two settings, but with a twist. This could also change the amount of particles displayed.
Brass quality.
I swear to god, if I have to explain the same thing one more time.
Soft shadows.
This setting makes shadows sharp. Okay, makes them softer.
Post-processing.
This usually means either depth of field or motion blur. Or both if you're feeling a little silly.
Model quality.
Remember when I said that everything in a game is made of images? Well, those textures have to be applied on a shape. Every character or weapon in place is made out of thousands of triangles. This setting changes how many triangles everything has.
Texture streaming.
Instead of loading all of the high quality textures in the entire map at the start, texture streaming loads in high quality textures when needed. This can help with load times if you have a slow hard drive.
Tessellation.
It sounds complicated, but it's actually pretty simple to grasp. All it does is add more polygons to your 3D models. It's very useful if a game developer wants to make something very bumpy, for example, without having to make a very detailed model.
Ambient occlusion.
Ambient occlusion is a shadowing technique used to make 3D objects look more realistic, by simulating the soft shadows that should naturally occur when indirect or ambient lighting is cast out onto your scene. And now for the final setting.
High dynamic range, HDR.
You know when you're in a really dark room for a while, and then when you see a bunch of light your eyes have to adjust? Well, HDR does the same. It simulates the way your eyes work by adjusting the brightness when you look at something very bright, like the sun. Phew, that was quite a lot of nerdiness. If you found this video useful or enjoyable, well, you know what to do. Boxled out.